Hi.
Hello. Thanks for coming.
Should we start?
Thank you.
Well, I have to say this is really exciting for me because Margo is my professor and she's my thesis advisor. And she was the first person who told me, you have to work on the way you end these essays because they're not landing right. And I was so mad, and she was so right.
She hid her anger.
I don't know if that's possible. But this, so I'm really honored, and it feels really full circle because I went to Columbia because of you and on Michael Jackson. This is so seminal. So this is, it's humbling in a full circle.
You all know Rachel's work. I am so dazzled as well as proud. But, you know, gotta be dazzled
because
you did.
Where to start? I ordered this book. Have you, when was the last time you saw that?
Oh my God, yes.
So in Margo's book, she talks about Althea Gibson. And I'm writing about Serena Williams.
And competitiveness. Serena Williams of her day, meaning she was the only one, however. Yeah.
Right.
And competitiveness, okay.
Right. And there's a moment in Negroland where you talk about going to a recital, a dance recital, and you obliterate, you say, another girl who's performing.
It's a little Jack and Jill recital.
Yeah.
And we're all supposed to have our moments.
Yeah.
But I was not content to wait for mine. So I went out on stage, told the pianist to play the music, performed something of my own composing, and got away with it because Negro, and I'm going to use the word when it's history specific, parents were so eager to be proud of something that seemed precocious within your group. I got away with it with the parents. I have no idea what I did with the child who just receded because, as I wrote, I was out to obliterate her, which I was. So clearly I was very competitive.
Very competitive.
From an early age, yes.
Well, it was so funny because I had done something really similar where my mom enrolled me in Suzuki violin and I had to do the ADGG, you know, the little things, and the other ones had the bow, and I was like, no, man, I can do the bow. So it was my turn just to do plucking, but they were doing, you know, and I was like, no, I'm taking over. And everyone thought it was cute, but I realized then also it was inappropriate.
Yes.
And you really nail that about how the ways in which black behavior is codified.
Yes, and black girl behavior,
right,
has the additional burden of, well, the triple burden, inappropriate girl behavior, but inappropriate doubly because you got the black curse and the black girl curse,
right,
going, right?
Right?
Yes, 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 yes.
And so I'm reading Althea Gibson, and one of the things you say that's so funny is I really didn't like this book. I really thought that she comes off kind of vulgar.
No recollection. Okay.
But
vulgar,
you say,
in what way?
Well, you say we would never talk about using the sort of hair oil she uses.
Dixie Peach.
Dixie Peach.
You weren't supposed to say Dixie glibly in the 50s if you were black.
And she talks a lot about pressing her hair and greasing,
yes,
her hair. And there's an openness that we don't do in our communities. In both your book and in this book, that are really, really important, though, even though they make you uncomfortable.
I think there was so, because of the position that black people were in, which was really in many ways caste status, you know, class status, not class notwithstanding, nothing was about you really was assumed to be normal. You know, it wasn't just nothing about your skin, nothing about the if you seemed to talk in a sort of standardized vernacular way, you might slip back into what was really considered normal black discourse, you know, which was, you know, what you saw in the movies, Step and Fetch It and whatever. Your hair, all of it was in some way abnormal. And you could regress, a word my sister and I used to use jokingly. You talk about your hair regressing.
Or going back.
So going back. So we try to claim, appropriate these terms and make them sort of household jokes. But because of that, you know, the availability, the pervasiveness of shame became huge. Right. So something normal, like talking about how you manage your hair, which you can see any woman of any race talking about now in any magazine, no, because this was supposed to be hidden away, even though everybody knew that people were looking at you, that other black people were looking at you and judging your greater hair, and other white people were looking at all of you and thinking, oh, you poor pitiful thing with that hair.
And Margo, you do this thing that's kind of like espionage and homage. Like, there's a moment in Negroland when you say, wow, she has a lot of affection and tenderness for this community that raised you, but at the same time, you're opening Pandora's box in terms of sort of the nervous condition of upper class blackness. Yeah. Did you have hesitation about that?
I had a huge amount of hesitation, and that's why I really began the book by essentially saying, my God, I was taught not to tell secrets, not to reveal anything about us because it could be used against us, especially if it was remotely suggestive of the unflattering, and you weren't supposed to show up because that was vulgar. So I knew that if I didn't air that immediately and use it, partly as a device that would push me, because once you say something out loud, you have to contend with it as a writer in some kind of way, but also use it dramatically, you know, to keep pushing at and to create complexity. If I didn't do that, I was kept getting stuck on this book until I wrote that opening passage, yeah.
And gave yourself
permission. And I love that phrase. I love espionage and homage, because that's absolutely right.
Yeah. And one of the things that I was really curious about is, how did you give yourself permission? And that's a crack question.
Gotcha.
Did you write that chapter first? Did you ask permission from the people you were going to? How do you go about doing that?
It's interesting because it is a craft question with any piece of work that has something to do with the personal. Call it a personal essay, call it a memoir, even call it, if you're writing about someone you interview whom you admire and they ask to see the quotes, you're opening yourself up to their judgment. So I wish I'd written that first because it would have made it a lot easier. I kept trying different things, and they weren't, you know, oh, I do a little short story-like scene, and, you know, they weren't working. Meaning, whenever material goes dead on you, I mean, you lose interest in it, then something is dreadful. So I kept pushing myself. The other thing I was trying to do was write in a kind of sequence. I've never done that. Even in my reviews, I kind of magpie it. I might start with a quote from a poem just to get me going. You know, then I'll free associate a little, then I'll do some research to stabilize myself, and then I'll start, you know, doing thematics of description, and then I'll put the kit together at the end. So I finally realized I could give myself permission to get rid of what I thought of as the appropriate narrative form for a memoir,
yes,
and collage it, you know? And I ended up with my editor, when he saw the first draft, he said, whoa, this is so collaged. Most readers, you know, your internal, you know, logic is so internal. He said, you know, a reader needs certain things to hold on to, momentum. So I had to go back and figure out how to do that. So there are there's a chronological order, and there is a collage order.
And there's a repetition.
Yes. Love repetition.
And there's a lot of doing day in terms of that repetition clicking in of, like, I have to open myself up to this. I don't want this to be grief. I don't want this to be sad. There's a way that you can fall into this thing.
Yes, and that also had to do with my realizing it could be, I didn't have to renounce. All those little scenes I was writing at the beginning were my way of saying, forget, you're not a critic. Now you have to be, you know, a nonfiction short story writer. Bring what you are into a damn memoir, okay?
You're such a critic.
I'm such a fan.
And one of the things that's so amazing when I was reading this is I said, whoa, I hope I've never done anything that offends Margo because she remembers everything. Shit. She's five and is like, someone cut me. And I'm like, are you, you know, so this is an amazing thing, this critical eye that you have. And one of the things that I took grad school with Margo, and she taught, Margo teaches the most like capacious text in terms of, we were reading Japanese text from, you know, 1002, Shoshana again in the pillow book.
Were, that's right.
And this is a book about like a Japanese woman who's living in a imperial court. Japan.
But she's a minor court one, but she's there.
And she's listing everything. You know, someone didn't bow to me today. I noticed how the leaf fell.
And 12 things that I hate. Colors that are attractive, but perhaps vulgar.
Yes. So there's this amazing lyricism to your critical eye that becomes a way of sort of delineating your personality.
I hope so. I like that.
You know, I start to, I kind of know you, but you know, we're not, you're someone I look up to, but I was like, wow, I know Margo now how she looks at the world. You know, a world view.
So it is in that way a critical eye, yeah, as an autobiographical, as a, yeah, revealing,
yeah,
confessional in some way. But it doesn't really want to confess, but it,
right,
does reveal.
Yes.
So in some way a revelation is always a confession.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. One of the things also I just wanted to ask you about is that you're dealing with this really murky history. How many of you have read the book in terms of the Uncle Lucius part cracks me up? So Margo, you talk a lot about passing.
Especially
in
the Uncle Lucius.
Uncle Lucius. And so I was reading it again today, and she talks about family members who were light enough to disappear into whiteness. And in a book that is so much involved in this critical eye and figuring out what is what and who is what and how things operate, this issue of passing creates this interesting, murky area. And one of the things you do with this uncle figure who goes to pass but then comes back to retire in the Black community, it say your parents weren't offended that he became white. They were offended that he didn't become a successful white person.
Exactly. Yeah. Because if you were going to, now my parents' generation, following, you know, this has been going on since we came to this country, miscegenation, and the Passover and the white community. But my father was born in 1908, my mother in 1916. In their generation, parents, all of them had friends who passed. And it wasn't at all uncommon. Actually, I remember my mother told me, Cab Calloway, the entertainer, his wife was an old grammar school friend of mine. And she came back for a family funeral. And she said, you know, Irma, I'm the only one of my eight brothers and sisters who lived as a Negro.
Yeah.
And, or there would be twins, you know, and one would be, I think I say that, was living as a white man, but his sister was living in Chicago as a, you know, Negro woman. So this was not at all uncommon, but it wasn't, in my household at least, it was not talked about until Uncle Lucius made his reappearance. And then we had to invite him over to dinner. He was a relative of my father. It was explained very briefly, you know, but we knew some little about this. And, you know, as I put it in the book, his retirement community was Negroland. So he came to dinner, and it was mesmerizing because knowing, I had grown up with a certain number of people who looked white.
Right.
And I knew, right, they were Negroes. So,
right,
okay, they looked white and they're Negro. But Uncle Lucius, he looked no more white than them, and they did, but he looked white and he had been living as a white man. So I found it very, very disorienting. Yeah. Yeah. And I thought, okay, so some of us look like them. So we've all been taught that we're equal to them, but I guess some of us are them. In fact, so this is strange. Uncle Lucius's story kind of turned into, well, it became a little sad. Uncle Lucius, well, actually, should I tell about that? Okay.
I'm fascinated.
All right, I'm going to tell
you. We read about Nella Larson, and we read about passing narratives, and then you have Uncle Lucius, who's just not this typical passing narrative.
It's not. I'm going to read a little bit of this, because it is. I like it better than I shall speak it. Okay, so I've talked my way through some of this already. My sister and I are told the basic story, our cousin Lillian Granberry Thompson looked as if her portrait could hang in the Museum of the Confederacy. Lillian, she said her father always told her, and she said this very boastfully, the best blood of Mississippi runs in your veins. She was a few years older than my father and chose to live as a fair-skinned Negro, passing for convenience when she wanted to patronize white-only restaurants, reaping the little rewards, deference here, flattery there, often granted her by brown-skinned Negroes. She was a trusted conduit between the passers and the non-passers. So she'd be the one on whom she'd contact. And this was very apparently familiar. When I grew older and my parents would talk about it, I did learn this was typically ritualistic. But what happened was, my father started opening up, and he told me that he had a white cousin whose original name had been John Eddie, but who, when he passed over to become white, had become John Edward. No little giveaways here. John Eddie had been living successfully in, I think, Minnesota. I just call it the state of him because I get quite obsessed with all the mysteries of this. And he died, and somehow or another, I don't know if he made a deathbed confession or if his white wife had already known, his children got wind of this, and they tracked him back to the black college called Rust College he had gone to in Mississippi. Conveniently, and my theory is that Rust understood perfectly well how to keep this kind of information from any white relative who might come looking. Conveniently, the officials at Rust said that John Eddy's records had been lost in a fire. They kept researching, they made their way to their grandmother's door. That would be my father's aunt. She did, as my father put it, what she was supposed to do. She said, I've never heard of that. And turned them away. It's a typical sacrificial black mother act, but it could also be construed as a final, rather revenge-filled slam of the door into their face and into John Eddy's face, too. None of you will get anything from me, but because you came to my door, you will have to live with this possibility for the rest of your life. Bam! Now, shortly after the first visit, I, in fact, never saw Uncle Lucius again. I think he visited a few more times, but here is where I'll finish reading. I have a picture of him on my father's cabin cruiser, the Valley High. He sits next to his sister, that's Aunt Bessie. He looks content. She looks ebullient. My father told me that once he settled in, he began to telephone his Negro relations and accuse them of neglecting him, psychologically transparent. But he'd been a prickly white man too, said my father, regularly disturbing his own peace by getting into fights when he heard people mock or demean Negroes, as he inevitably did at the white bars and restaurants he invariably went to. They don't talk about anything but us, what we do, how we look, how much they hate us, he told my father. But they must have talked about something else sometime. And the ordinary talk of ordinary white men must have been a comfort to Uncle Lucius in those early days. He could handle the nasty turns at first, till he couldn't. Then he'd fuss and fight and make himself a target of anger, of suspicion. So when the time came to retire, he retired, retreated, and settled among Negroes. But he wasn't really a Negro anymore. He was a former white man. And my parents looked down on him a little, not because he'd passed, but because he'd risen no higher than traveling salesmen. if you were going to take the trouble to be white, you were supposed to do better than you could have done as a Negro.
Which is very much the black elite's view of all white people who are not at least their equal. And so you could have had anything, even if you could have had anything and look at you. Yeah. It's another form of revenge. Yeah.
And it's another form of pressure for you.
For moi.
Indeed. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
And one that you sort of rebel against.
Well, I
throughout this text.
How do you feel that I rebel? By writing the text?
Yes.
And exposing everything?
Yes.
That is true. Because I didn't rebel by my behavior until the 60s. I mean,
no.
I did what I was supposed to do. You achieve, you're a good girl, you're a lady, you do well in school. You know, even the 60s, it's entirely appropriate that I, embraced black power and then the women's movement and argued a lot with my parents. That's, fine, This didn't put me at great risk,
right?
So you're right, the only real rebellion was to remain despised.
Yes.
In the house of Negroland. And render it with all the complexity I could, but also render what made me and also what made to me.
Right. And that's an amazing sentence. And one of the things that's so complicated with this book is the title.
Yes, it's true.
Negroland. And I've heard you talk about writing this memoir for years. And then I saw the title one day. And I said, Negroland.
What's she doing?
Yeah. And I said, whoa, I'm going to have to buy a book called Negroland.
And I may have to take the jacket off when I'm reading it.
The jacket's too beautiful, I think, to take. The jacket's amazing. But I want to know, I read your Guardian interview. And you talk about feeling like that was a risk. It concerned you, or it
absolutely
troubled
did.
You.
Yeah.
And why?
Because you cannot say the word Negro without, or use it without it setting off all these charged historical associations. It was rejected at a certain point in the really mid-60s, and it has never been picked up again, except by Negroes being very reactionary about it. I don't need to name names here.
Right.
I think you know some of the people I'm speaking
of. Calling. One time I came somewhere and someone said, oh, Negro, you're here. And I said, we might have a problem. He's a black person, but it was just, I'm 34. I've never been called a Negro before.
No. And, it even became for some, this is what we need to move back to assert the worthy values. So I thought, that's horrifying. What I wanted this word to do, this coined word, I wanted it to signify a time and a place. The time was nomenclature, what we call ourselves. It's such a charged part of our history. It's charged as internally, skin color, hair, class status. Negro succeeded colored people as the appropriate. The progressive, even the radical word in the early years of the 20th century. You can kind of chart it because the NAACP was formed in the late 19th and they were still using colored people. But the new Negro, capitalize it, this was a bold and brave term that was embraced. And I still grew up being born in the late 40s, very much in its powerful, in the sun and shadow of it. It was honorable. The fight to get it capitalized was a huge fight. I don't think the New York Times started capitalizing it till the 30s. So all of this represented a certain kind of struggle, and I was really writing about that period, that world. I combined it with land because a land is a literal and a mythic space. We lived, all black people, we lived such
an internal, enclosed life, which was sometimes, and in some ways, just glorious, and in other ways, obviously, precarious and perilous and punitive. But I wanted that sense of a land that, you know, a group of people, whatever their differences, they share certain cultural things. Because most cities, certainly Chicago, were so segregated, land could stand in, Negroland, for those segregated neighborhoods. And lands are very much, particularly small ones. Homeland is very negative. If you think of South Africa, it can be positive in other ways. But small lands are always imperiled by the larger land around them. And that was all in my head, too.
One of the things that's so interesting about Negroland, if it's a land, is that it's not a patriarchy in this book. It's a matriarchy.
Right. Yes, that's right. That's absolutely right.
And is that something that you said, I want this to be a story? I mean, your mother and your sister are very much centered.
Yes.
As a sort of tip trick that you're engaging with throughout this book.
Constantly, yeah.
And one of the things we're talking about so much right now in this moment is, where are women of color and black women centered in this conversation of race? And is that something that you had to decide to sort of put your father to the background and bring your mother and your sister to the fore, or?
It wasn't hard to decide. I you know, the black women and our charged and changing positionality, and also this constant struggle of and between gender and race and class, particularly as it is marked, you know, as gender and class mark each other in race. That was just my obsession. That's what I wanted it to be about. To be fair to my father, who actually was in many ways as unpatriarchal as a man of that generation could be, I just simply did not know him nearly as well. He was at the hospital, at the office. He was he was quieter, and he was melancholy. My mother and sister were the really, you know, he kept it all going, because in those days, the father was the one who earned everything. He made it, as my mother used to say, Ronald made it all possible. You know that one. But my mother and sister were absolutely pivotal. They were the starring players in my life. And my mother and her friends were a source of endless fascination to me. They were very stylish. Some of them were serious professionals. One of my father's partners, doctor partners, was a woman. They were lawyers, but they were teachers. They were also housewives and socialites, and they thoroughly enjoyed that. So, you know, watching them do that, you know, we moved between their genteel diction and their playful Southern black vernaculars, and, you know, it was just endlessly fascinating to me, watching this masquerade and cavalcade of styles, manners, shaping themselves, and nobody in the larger world really being aware of that.
Right.
You know, and yet it was a world that they lived out fully, you know, as if it were at the center of the cosmos.
And your mother writes that letter, and she shows it to you, where she says, I'm so happy I almost forgot.
I'm a Negro. That's right. The letter was written in 1944, I think it was. She would have been pregnant with my sister. She was newly married to my father, who was at Fort Huachuca, an all-black, segregated fort in the Army. And she was, you know, she was very happy in those days, and she was writing a black friend, and she just said at the very end of the letter, she was telling the friend to give her best wishes to another newly engaged friend, and she said, you know, I wish her all the happiness I have, you know, because I'm so happy. Sometimes I almost forget I'm the Negro, and last line, and that's something. And when I found this letter and I read it aloud to my sister and niece, who I believe is here. Francesca, do you remember hearing that letter?
Yes.
Sometimes I almost forget.
Yeah.
Yeah, there she is. And my great niece.
Oh,
I read this and I, you know, I know it was mirrored in my face. Denise, my sister, and Fran were just stricken. Because my mother was very, my parents were very careful, very watchful, as many Black parents were, about what they told us. We had to be told enough about race and bigotry and racism to be prepared. They were careful about what personal stories they passed on to us. And I think it was a combination of wanting to protect us and wanting to protect themselves. They did not want to tell, you know, until they had control over it, or we were old enough, stories of humiliation or loss.
And shame. Shame is a big word in this.
Yes.
Shame.
Yes, that's right.
And you repeat it over and over again, and different people feel ashamed. There's one thing, though, I got the sense of, and I just wanted to ask you, do you think your mother knew that you were going to be a writer?
That's interesting. She would have liked to be. And
she would have.
Yes. Well, yeah. That was one of her dreams. I'm still trying to track down a story she apparently published in a white newspaper when she was a little girl.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And she wrote some song lyrics with a friend, and she wrote very well. She loved literature. I got encouraged when I was young, but then I got distracted because I had some talent at the piano, and then I wanted to be an actress, and she was very happy when I became a writer. She wanted us both to be artistic, however, not at the cost of getting college degrees and master's degrees.
Right.
And
having something, as you say, to fall back on.
Back on, that's right. That's right. Also, right. You know, women in our family, But she was proud that I became, she was proud of
a
that.
A Pulitzer Prize winner.
She was very proud of that, yes. I had to be very careful with her, though, when I was writing this book. She knew I was writing it, and I managed to show her a few chapters that were flattering to her, that I knew she would love, like
her clothes,
the one about her clothes, and how wonderful they were to me. And also one about all of us watching TV, watching those first, you know, all across Negro America, you know, with anybody, Sammy Davis Jr., Billy Eckstein, Lena Horne, Dorothy Dandridge, the Giant Girl was going to appear on a TV show. Everyone would be called and you'd have to watch it that night. And then you'd take apart every little iota of the behavior of the host. You know, was Ed Sullivan polite enough? Or, right. You know, the, and
why is Sammy Davis Jr. up there with those two old
minstrels? Those old two minstrels were his uncle or whatever. He's moved beyond that now. Why is Dorothy Dandridge singing Mercy, Mr. Percy, stop picking on me when Mr. Percy sounds like she's talking to a slave master? But Lena Horne, she's gorgeous. So we did all that. So I knew she'd enjoy that. Yeah. But periodically, you know, she'd say, I knew I had to protect myself. And then she'd say, you know, Margo, I'm really a very private person. And I said, right. And no, Mother, please. And I would turn back into a good girl and say, and then change the subject. I would say, oh, Mom, I know. And then we'd go on. So I just, that was something I was struggling with. And also, every time one of her friends, male or female, found out I was writing the book, he or she would say, something like, nobody really understands what we've done. So finally you're going to tell about our world.
That's my next question. Because, you know, I'm a little bit of a stalker. Anyone who writes nonfiction, I think, is a stalker.
Yes.
So, or just a creepy person. So you dedicate this to Nancy.
Yes.
And I found an article from the Harvard something from 1968 where she's quoted saying, you know, I like integration, but I don't like having to explain things to all these white people. And
Was it Wellesley? It was Harvard. Okay.
And she was saying, you know, Wellesley's cool, but this is terrible the way they just ask me all these questions. And one of the things that's, like, so curious about this moment is you have Daryl Pinkney, writing Black Deutschland, you have you writing this book. And so all of you all are sort of cracking open these stories and explaining ourselves in this wider format of literature, how we exist in these private ways. And what I'm wondering about is, why do you think that's happening now?
Maybe, partly, I mean, you've given me a thread with the Nancy Gist story. Mm-hmm. What Nancy was protesting on behalf of all of us was that state we were in for so long of not having any control over what the questions were, the nature of the questions, which therefore somewhat limits the frame, the nature, the power even of the answers. We're now asking the questions and providing more questions or provisional answers, and also, which brings me to back to this famous debate that I know you follow obsessively, but the old debate that Irving Howe, the critic, started about James Baldwin, Ralph Ellison, and Richard Wright, and who was more authentically Black. Oh, you didn't know that one.
Well, no, I don't know that one.
You know what? Isn't it nice that your generation missed certain things? Yeah. Some of that is anyway. This became, you know, a big thing, and Irving Howe really basically said, you know, you couldn't be Black and not be in a state of unmitigated rage all the time, like Native Son. But you know, if you read
Richard Wright, I was going to say was going to be the Blackest.
Right. But if you read Black Boy, actually, Richard Wright's emotions are more complex. But he was going to be the Blackest. So Ellison, you know, really very intelligently, you know, parried and thrust, and you know, Baldwin, I don't think he ever answered it, but he punished Richard Wright. He punished him with a very harsh review some years.
Oh, that review was amazing.
It really is. And that's a perfect example of, you know, having that literary right in fiction or nonfiction to delineate, create, remember, reconstitute the world, and what you tell and how you tell it, and all the subtleties, and not have the definition pre-imposed. And I think that's what's happening now.
In your class, another book that you taught us was Victor Slosky, Third Factory. And it's
Radical Russian Futurist Writer.
Radical Russian Futurist Writer. I have the book here.
Wow.
You guys can see it. And he develops this theory of defamiliarization.
Yeah.
And it's something that I really love, that I saw in Negroland. Because whenever I expected Margo to have a typical reaction to something, she had a completely atypical reaction to something I thought I understood. So the Black Power movement kind of starts to occur. And Margo says, yeah, I adopted Black Power to cut off people I didn't want to hang out with anymore. I said, yes. But, you know, in all of these moments, so what you start to do.
Deeper motives also.
Yeah. You create a new sense of how we perceive these moments that define Blackness. And they create entryways for unexpected avenues of Blackness. And was that something that you decided, hey, I want to do that, or is that just who you are? Because as a critic, you write about such interesting things. I don't know if you have read on Michael Jackson, but the way she perceives Michael Jackson is a geography. And it's not a hagiography. It's not, oh, this saint we have to be precious about, oh, this pervert we have to be condemning about. It's a complicated narrative of all of us.
Yeah, it's like how many eyes go around. And in this, these many, many features in the landscape.
So you're always throwing us off. And I think it's really important when you're saying, you know, in this conversation of Blackness, to make it unfamiliar. You don't know us, because we don't always know ourselves.
Exactly. So something that seems very deep is going to be coexisting with something that's very trivial.
Right.
For given what you just cited, right? A little social da-da-da-da-da.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, you know, you teach things that you want to learn from. And a dear friend, actually, when I was just starting to write, who's also mad about Russian literature, said, Margo, take a look at this. It's an amazing way to construct a memoir.
Yeah.
The First Factory is his childhood. This is all he's writing in the Russian Revolution. The second factory is the formalist movement that he joined, and the third factory is really the revolution. You know? Right. So it was very useful to me.
It was. Yeah. You did use it. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And it was so useful, I think, in this text, because we don't think of Black lives as being theoretical, I think, and I think that that's really important.
No, I think that's absolutely right. Which is something that all your pieces really focus on, whether it's Dave Chappelle, or Toni Morrison, or that's, you are very focused on this.
Well, I like
or,
the theory.
Or Kendrick Lamar.
Yeah.
You know, blues.
Yeah.
Yes, you always did. That's right.
Yeah, I see people like, are you still into Adorno? And I'm like, oh, that's college shit. Don't play me out. But, you know, I think it's really important to just say, to make us uneasy. And I have to be honest, when I was reading this book today, I made a really stupid decision to take a train, from South Carolina last night at 9 o'clock to New York. And I was reading Negroland, and one of the things that just kept happening is that I said, wow, America's really weird. And the way you set up this history of that we don't know who's Black, and we don't know who's Negro, and we don't know who's white, was probably the most honest relationship to race that I've read in a really long time. And this idea that we don't completely supersede power to white people either. We have private power and private hierarchies.
Oh, many, 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 many. Yeah, and they aren't only, which used to be the kind of sociological explanation, you know, they aren't only reflections of our own self-hatred and desire to imitate.
Right.
No, they are also built. I mean, some of them are predictable and can be imitated, you know, can be found in every other culture, you know, class. But some of them are very particularly and peculiarly themselves and come very much out of, you know, our cultural and social history and our manners and the regions we come from mix. And even the way, you know, class can be very rigid in the Black world, but there are all these little style fissures.
Yes.
You know, sure.
Jack and Jill.
Yes.
The boulet.
Yes. No style fissures there.
Do you know about the Jack and Jill boulet? I didn't know about this until I was 18. I grew up in Philadelphia, and where Jack and Jill was founded, mind
indeed.
You. So I don't know how I escaped this, but I remember I was in a Wawa, which is a convenience store, and a very light-skinned, very elegant woman came up to me, and she said, oh, where do you go to school? I was talking to my predominantly white girlfriends, and she said, oh, where do you go to school? I said, oh, Friends Select, Quaker's private school. And she said, oh, you must know Jack. You're in Jack and Jill. I said, no, I prefer Breyers. I thought she was talking about the ice cream. And she was done with me. I mean, she went, oh. And so these codifications of who belongs and who doesn't belong.
According to, you know, a very specific set of codes.
Codes.
The school that you were in, the fact that you were, if you were talking to your white friends, you were probably talking standardized white English. If you've been talking to, you know, a group of your Black buddies and you were all doing girlfriend, she might have just passed you by.
Right.
She couldn't be a Jack and Jill. She would have gotten soon enough to what, if you'd said, oh, but I'd like to be, or am, she would have immediately gone to what your parents do.
Right.
You know, this is like old-fashioned American snobbery.
And you
there's
do this
nothing
in your
original
book.
About that.
But you set up your parents' entire genealogy in those first pages.
I do.
Why did you do that?
Also, well, I set up the genealogies of the so-called, again, speaking of names, this world and their instability, this world has called itself and been called the colored elite, the Black elite, the Black bourgeoisie, the Negro upper middle class, the African American upper class. But what I first tried to do was set up historically all the divisions over some centuries that created those. Well, you know, first you're talking about very fundamental divisions.
Right.
Free Negroes, enslaved Negroes. Then you start breaking it down a little more into these particulars you're talking about. Free Negroes with some property, free Negroes without. Dark-skinned free Negroes, lighter's den, free Negro. Then you go over to the slave side, house servant, field, and so on and so on and so forth. And you know, that mutates into professionals, doctors and lawyers, teachers. Well, if you work in the post office, that's fine because you had a college degree and so many other jobs as a black person you could have gotten were closed. Then the clothes start proliferating. How long your ancestors were free starts to count.
I don't know any of this. My mind's blown. I'm like, tell me more.
I'm trying to do. How long they were free? Was it just, there's a funny line in one, I think it's in Intisaki Shange's For Colored Girl, where she refers, with brazen irony to, oh Lord, I was dating one of these Negroes whose great, great, great granddaddy was a Reconstruction senator. And I also wanted to break down, were there white ancestors? If they were, nobody ever would insist. No one would ever acknowledge that you might have descended from an overseer. No, it was like my Aunt Lillian, my cousin Lillian, the best blood of Mississippi. It could have been an overseer's blood, but her father was not going to let me know. So this was never discussed, though it was understood how much rape had to do with it. Indian blood. And sometimes African blood, if it was African royalty and it didn't show up too much in your features, was considered quite august, depending again on the region of the country.
Wow.
So I wanted to set that up to show the complexities, the absurdities, also how, among black people, but in this strange, perverted country of ours, classes and aristocracies and underclasses are invented, made up, willed, insisted upon, improvised and then codified. And then I wanted to put my own family within that. We come from, both modest and more modest and less modest. It was mixed. I could hear a my mother possibly saying, well, do you really want to say all of that? And then she would have laughed. I said, yes, Mother, I do. Because she once said to me, it's so interesting, she said, she was talking about her father's mother and aunt. And she said, Margo, she said they were in service and they were very dark skinned. Loved those women with all my heart. Okay. Must have been in the late 60s, maybe, that she wanted to tell me that. Yeah, that she was rethinking this. But if you've been married a doctor, to have older relatives who've been in service was something you had to come to terms with.
Right.
And decide to live with or decide to hide, which she did not. But there was always something that you could be looked down on a little for, because anything that gets put together out of so much deprivation and pressure requires a lot of work for maintenance. So the early part of the book is a very long historically based essay about how this class evolves, because they didn't want readers to go into my story and my life without having that material. They would have made too many presumptions, assumptions, etc.
There's black cool and then there's black nervousness. And we never talk about black nervousness.
And we talk
all the time about black cool.
Wow.
Maze was so cool, everyone's so cool, and in the colonial period in Africa, you have a lot of African writers talking about nervous conditions, and you have Fanon talking about feeling uneasy, right? And the colonial predicament making us feel uneasy. And one of the things I loved in your book, you have Woody Allen being completely uneasy and neurotic all the time, but you never see black characters that are neurotic. One of the things I love, have you seen Issa Rae's Awkward Black Girl?
Yes.
I love
this.
She's neurotic.
She's neurotic. She's she's clumsy and gawky. She knows that she can't make it better.
Right.
Yes.
And it was a relief to read your book because I said, oh, Margo is perfect, brilliant, and gorgeous, and she's nervous sometimes, I guess.
A lot of the time.
Yeah.
She's very nervous. In fact, you could even say neurotic.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, in the book, you remember everything. So there's this moment, though, that I wondered, do you think that's a genre that's going to develop as we get more comfortable with outing these stories? Or do you think it's something that's always existed, and it's up to us just to sort of reveal it? I mean, I'm sure, I love the trailer for Issa Rae where the guy comes up to her to talk. She thinks he's talking to her, but he's really talking to her friend, and she goes, you know? And everyone has that motion if you've ever been a girl, but you don't really see black girls doing that, right? Saying, oh, I'm not sexually harassed. I'm not completely confident. I'm actually insecure.
And I'm going to kind of try to peep out of the frame right now. I'm not going to brazen my way through it, right? I'm going to go, girlfriend. Yeah. No, I'm really not going to. Well, I think comedy is where it's going to first develop. You know, you can see inklings of it in Dave Chappelle.
All the time he's insecure.
Yeah, and actually, so was Richard Pryor.
Incredibly insecure.
He brazened his way, but my God.
Who burns himself up after a crack high and then says, you're going to wash me?
This nigger is crazy.
Yeah.
But when you even look at earlier routines, this is manic depression.
This is
total manic depression.
Right.
I bond. Yeah, absolutely. So, no accident for women. It's awkward black girl is one. I don't know what someone like Leslie Jones would do with this because she's working in a more predictable frame right now.
Yeah.
I don't know how things could be turned around. It would be interesting to see someone like Taraji P. Henson, who played Cookie, play a vulnerable, neurotic, high-strung, whatever character. I mean, I just don't know. But comedy is definitely the
Your
first
book
brain.
Is
also,
so funny, too.
Fiction.
Yeah.
Fiction. And memoir, but writing, definitely. Yeah.
Your book, there are moments when I laugh so hard.
Oh, good. I'm so glad.
And I didn't know if that was intentional, where I said, Margo is hilarious.
Oh, good.
I mean, this is a black power moment. The moment when you're at a dinner party and you said, I don't wipe my butt all the time.
I'm a child.
At a dinner party and you say, I don't wipe my butt all the time.
Sometimes I forget to wipe myself. I was trying to be a little more genteel.
Yeah. And everyone at the dinner party is caught off guard. I'm sitting here, that's hilarious. I mean, and it's this like primer in comedy of how people approach it, but you also talk about it being a sort of coping mechanism.
Huh, the comedy.
The humor.
The humor. Wait. Oh no, humor absolutely is. That's right. There's that terrible moment when my mother acknowledges that she has gone to Sears Roebuck to buy some appliances, and who should she run into but our white laundry.
Can you read that one? I love this one.
Everybody is so mad.
Because Margo had white workers.
Well, he had a few white workers. And he came to the back door, okay? So you just wait and see how he beats his revenge. Mr. Johnson. They think he lives near us. It's a big neighborhood, Mother says. Why would we know their janitor? White people think Negroes all know each other, and they always want you to know their janitor. Do they want to know our laundryman?
Well,
That would be Wally. A smiling, big-shouldered white man who delivers crisply wrapped shirts and cheerful greetings to our back door every week.
Good morning, Mrs. Jefferson, he would say.
Good morning, Doctor. Hello, girls. Hello, Wally, we'd chime back from the breakfast table. Then one weekend afternoon, I was in the kitchen with Mother doing something minor and domestic, like helping unpack groceries, when she said slowly, not looking at me, I saw Wally at Sears today. I was looking at vacuum cleaners, and I looked up and saw him. Here she paused for the distancing Rodgers and Hammerstein irony across a crowded room. He was turning his head away, hoping he wouldn't have to speak. Wally, the laundryman, was trying to cut me. If this had been drama, she would have paused and done something with a telling prop, one of the better brands of an everyday food or a nice-looking piece of flatware. Then she said, and I don't even shop at Sears except for appliances. Humor is laughing at what you haven't got when you ought to have it. This is a riff on a Langston Hughes definition of humor. In this case, the right to snub or choose to speak kindly to your laundryman in a store where he must shop for clothes and you shop only for appliances. Still, Wally went on delivering laundry with cheerful deference, and we responded with cooler, but not intrusively cool, civility. Wally was never to be forgiven.
He was never to be forgiven. But he was not fired.
You know, they did not, my parents did not call up the service and say, don't ever bring him again. Mm. So I think, actually, again, I think there was anxiety and maybe a little, almost intimidation. Mm. Do I call the service and say, what, am I going to tell them why? No, you know? No.
And in the Black upper class, the way that you all do this sort of work, it also is like a way of inoculating yourselves from those insults.
Yes.
I mean, you go to a you go to an alternate world where you have camps, you have organizations,
absolutely.
You have dinners, you have events you're doing that they don't know anything about. And you even talk about when you invite two white girls to the party, you all think so carefully where they can have access.
And which ones will reflect well on us at this party. They have to dance nicely, but not try to like show off on the dance floor too much. They have to bring, we're inviting girls, because it's an all-girls club with the preposterous name, the Etiquettes.
No, I pronounced that, I guess.
It was made up.
Yeah.
No reason you should. They had to bring cute boys, you know, who could also dance and look good. And they had to be people, girls, and who with their dates would understand that we were bestowing an honor on them. So we picked very carefully and it worked. And actually, just a few weeks ago in Martha's Vineyard, I ran into a high school classmate of my sister's who still remembered being one of the only white people invited to one of her parties all these years later. And he needed to tell me, and he said it was thrilling, but it was also the first time he had ever experienced what Denise was experiencing every day, which was, I'm totally the minority here, and I have to find a way to behave. Again, not to show off, to behave, to fit in, you know, and to, you know, reflect well on my people.
Did having a sister make these sort of integrationists period in your life easier because you had someone to, there's a moment where she says, I'm suddenly around white people. And you said, everyone in your class before then had straight hair. What are you talking about, sister? And it's a sister conversation.
Yes.
You have your memory wrong.
Yes, exactly. But she said, but they didn't have bangs, Margo.
Yeah.
So the shock for her going to an all-white school, or almost all-white, second grade, was boys with bangs. None of the Negro
because
boys who looked white had bangs.
The upper class
and
was already light.
And the features she could deal with, but the bangs, she could not.
She could not.
No, we would compare notes.
You would.
A lot. Now, in some ways, there was more segregation, though they crossed lines. But there, you know, the social separation was pretty clear unless you were a beatnik. You know, blacks dated blacks, wasps dated wasps, Jews dated Jews, Catholics dated Catholics. You know, with tiny little crossings over.
But by the time I got graduated from college in high school in 64, so civil rights was starting, the legacy of the Beats, was sort of kicking in. So, Denise would sometimes just query me. She wanted to be sure that in my integration modes and ways and habits, I wasn't being too naive.
And that you were information.
That exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And she did once look at me, and I think it was in my cheerleading heart, and she said, "God, Margo, you're so all American."
Which is things big sisters, the way big sisters
could be. And she was and she was definitely being more boho at that point. But it was very helpful. It also kept, talked about the expectations and the demands of parents. We could skirt, take it on. We could compare notes, and we could say to each other sometimes, "This is really hard."
You're from Hyde Park, where?
Well, I was first.
You were first in Brownsville.
In Brownsville, then Park Manor, which was all black. That became, well, it started all white. My parents and some other people integrated, and then it speedily became all black. Mm-hmm. Then we moved to Hyde Park.
And Obama is from Hyde Park.
Obama was from Hyde Park, that's right.
And I want to talk a little bit about how that community may have, as you see it, we've talked about Chicago before, because I went and I said, wow, Chicago's a thoroughly black city. I just come back, I saw Margo at a event for Sarah Lewis's.
Oh yeah.
And I had just gone to the Kerry James Marshall show.
Let's just finish this. We'll do some questions too.
But really quickly, this sort of black elite in some way gives way to a 21st century version of black power. I think that the one you're coming out of.
Yes, actually I think that is true, because we retooled ourselves to do that. My generation, thank God, was forced to be. And chose to be. It's thrilling to be in the midst of civil rights, the black power, women's movement, gay rights. You felt you could remake yourself. You could throw off a lot of stuff. So I think those of us who made that transition worked hard and were very blessed to be able to do that work.
And for us to stand on the shoulders of that, our generation.
Well, you're making your own ways that we need, that we're learning from too.
Yeah.
Yeah.